Does the bond market know something you don't? This week, we saw a significant drop in interest rates. The 10-year yield dropped more than 10 basis points this week. That's a pretty big move for those of you that are not too familiar with interest rates. In fact, the analysts at JP Morgan say this move is a third standard deviation divergence from their estimated fair value framework, which is basically just saying that the move is extremely unusual and unexpected. So, why do we care? Well, the Treasury market has the reputation of being the smartest and most sophisticated market out there, and it often sees things before other markets do. Falling rates could be a bearish sign for the rest of the market. So today, we're going to discuss the possible factors that could be behind this move and how much we should be concerned. Hi, I'm Speculator Seth, here to bring you insights from the front lines of the trading world, and I'm really excited to be talking about interest rates today. The Treasury market has always been my specialty, so yeah, it's nice to geek out a little, especially since this is information that every investor can benefit from knowing. I plan on having much more content on current market conditions here on the channel in the future, so make sure you subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you don't miss future videos. Now, I know that interest rates can be an intimidating subject, but I think we're going to be able to keep things fairly digestible today. Of course, if you have any questions, just leave them in the comments below. Also, remember that I live stream every day starting at 8:20 Eastern time, and that can be a great time to get more information about some of my insights. So, why did interest rates fall last week? Well, there's a number of theories, and in a situation like this, it's difficult to empirically prove what is moving the market the most. All we can do is look at the different factors that could be at play. Then, in the future, when we get more information, we can compare that to what we already know and see which theories the new information best supports. Usually, though, there's going to be more than one factor at play, and probably all of these factors play a part in what is going on. The Delta variant. Over the past week, there's been a number of headlines concerning the spread of the Delta variant. A lot of headlines have focused on how effective existing vaccines will be against the new variant, with some studies suggesting a 60 to 80% efficacy. This is probably why, even though we are seeing a rise in cases worldwide, we aren't really seeing a rise in hospitalizations or deaths. So that means it shouldn't be a problem, right? Well, not quite. For starters, there's still a number of places that are struggling to move past the crisis. I would point to Australia in particular as an example. There are still areas under lockdown there, and the rise in cases from the Delta variant could complicate authorities' efforts to open things up again. Also, countries that lag in vaccinations that could see some impact from the new variant. So even though we might not see tons of deaths in the US from the new variant, there could still be impacts on consumer behaviors and labor supply, which means a slightly slower than expected economic recovery. The Fed pivot. So a few weeks ago, there was a bit of market drama over the dot plot that was released from the last Federal Reserve meeting. The dot plot is basically a calendar showing what the different members of the Federal Reserve Board think interest rates will be at future meetings. Two of these dots moved forward, meaning that they think rates will rise faster than they originally anticipated. But wait, didn't I say interest rates are falling right now? Why would they fall if the Federal Reserve thinks that they're going to rise? Well, rates did rise at first immediately after that meeting. Here's a chart. On the day of the FOMC statement, on the 16th, we saw a pretty big drop in prices, which means yields were rising. Remember, Treasury prices and yields move opposite of each other's. Ever since then, though, the move has reversed, and some market participants are suggesting that this is indicating a lack of confidence in the Fed. Basically, the market is concerned that the Fed could make a policy mistake, and that could be exacerbating this latest move. Which brings us to fears over secular stagnation, because you see, all of the economic reports we've had since that FOMC meeting have been bad. The jobs report on the 2nd of July in particular seemed to really affect the Treasury market, with the unemployment number actually increasing a little bit. This seemed to spill over after the holiday weekend, when the markets opened up again with strong action in the Treasuries. Then the services PMI numbers came in under market expectations. And this is basically a measure of economic activity in the services industry. It was still a positive number, but it suggested that the strongest periods of growth are already behind us. That's not very good when the long-term concern is our ability to maintain strong growth to pay off the huge amount of debt that countries have taken on during the pandemic. This would mean that the Federal Reserve can't raise rates without having an adverse impact on the economy, and thus the Treasury market may be pricing in lower interest rates for longer. Basically, the same story that we've been seeing for 12 years now since the 2008 crisis. And you combine this with all of China cracking down on its own tech companies and everything else that's gone on this week, the markets had plenty of reasons to question their growth projections. Then there's the repo thing. At the last board meeting, the Federal Reserve made some changes in how they administer short-term rates to address the massive amount of money that is being parked at the Fed's reverse repo facility, normally something that only geeks like myself really care about. This is where banks give the Federal Reserve money in exchange for some short-term bills, with the agreement to give the bills back a few days later. The Federal Reserve increased the interest rate the bills pay out by 5 basis points, and this might be having spillover effects to the other Treasury markets. Which brings us to the last point, which is the supply and demand dynamics in the Treasury market. The market was massively short the Treasury market as part of the whole reflation and recovery narrative. When shorts cover, they have to buy Treasuries, and that pushes the interest rates down. Then on top of all of that, the Federal Reserve has already bought up a ton of Treasuries as part of their quantitative easing program. So there's all these people buying and not a lot of supply because the Fed already gobbled it all up. And this last point is the one that I personally think is probably the most significant right now. The order flow that I see every day doesn't exactly suggest a long-term play on an economic collapse here. What I see suggests a lot of stop runs and forced buying. Many of these runs happen on their own without any corresponding move in currencies or equities or other markets. And that suggests to me that this is more about the supply and demand in the Treasury market itself than anything else. It looks like I'm not the only one with this opinion either. In a Deutsche Bank survey this past week, the supply-demand factor appeared to have the strongest support as the reason for the move. Remember that Treasuries tend to be more prone to mean reversion than other instruments, so while this move is important, I wouldn't be surprised if we see it come back a little bit. Overall, it does look like the market could be repricing the trajectory of the recovery, but it doesn't look like the Treasury market is predicting an outright crash as of yet. We'll be getting some important data points in the next week, including points on inflation, that should make the picture much more clear as we go. This may just be something specific to bonds, and it might lead to some great buying opportunities in other assets. That certainly appeared to be the case this last week with the huge dip and recovery that we got in equities. We've had pretty easy trading over the last year, and it looks like we're gonna have to work a little bit harder for those gains going forward. In other words, traders gonna trade. I'll see you when I'm streaming, and in the meantime, stay profitable, friends.